This is Dr. Pramila here, a pediatric dentist. Am I live? Is there anyone there? Okay, so maybe we'll wait for some time before everyone joins in and then start the session. If you have any doubts on the dental caries or dental health of children, COVID or no COVID, you can put it down in the messages or the comment section. And then even after the session is over, I guess I can have a look at it and get back to you. Hi, Moms and Stories. I guess that should be Reshma. Hi. Can you hear me? Hello, am I clear? Can you hear me? Akhila, maybe you can help me. Can you hear me? Am I clear when I speak like this? Okay. So I guess we'll wait for another 2-3 minutes and then we can start. It's wonderful to have you all here, Akhila, Anisha, Aisha. Okay, so we are going to talk about oral care during COVID. There is not much of difference between dental care during COVID, before COVID, after COVID, or anything like that in general. So brushing twice plays the most important role, especially for the kind of processed food and the sugar that our kids take in. So brushing twice is the minimum that we have to make sure they do it. Healthy food, again, is very important. We'll discuss about diet and dental caries a little later. Coming to limiting sugary drinks and snacks. So this is the point which is very important. Either during summer holidays or the present COVID lockdown situation, we have to limit the number of snacks. And every snack that is given, we have to make sure, we have to look into the sugar content of that snack and the carbohydrate consistency, which plays a very important role in deciding whether the food is cariogenic, caries causing or not. Then another important thing that we have to take care, especially during this lockdown or a holiday time, is regarding their hydration. We have to make sure the kids remain hydrated, because it is only when they are hydrated is the enough saliva formed, and the saliva has a very self-cleansing action in the oral cavity, especially when the child is sleeping. It's the saliva which continuously cleans the mouth and keeps it clean. Coming to the type of brush and the paste, I guess this is the most common question that I get asked, which is the best brush or which is the best paste for children. First, coming to the brush, the most important thing that we have to look into when we are picking up a brush for our children is the size of the brush head. So the brush head should be small and the bristles should be extremely soft. The softer the bristles, the better it is for children. Also, especially if you know, we are going to be brushing their teeth, we have to make sure it reaches the back teeth. So if the head is big, that might be a little difficult. battery operated brushes or the electric brushes do have a better cleaning efficiency, but still the child or the parent, we have to take it to all the surfaces of the teeth. That said, coming to the paste, the fluoride content of the paste is the determining factor on which paste is better for children. So if the child is say 5 years and below, it is better to use a zero fluoride paste because the kids may not be able to spit out completely, and if fluoride is being swallowed, it is not good. And from 5 to maybe 8.5, 9, we can use a mildly fluoridated paste. That is, the consistency of fluoride in the paste should be somewhere between 350 to 500 ppm. You can always check it. It is written in the box. It's mandatory. And beyond that, kids can use the adult paste, which have a very high concentration of fluoride. So all our usual Colgate, Pepsodent, Close-Up, all that we use have fluoride somewhere between 1000 to 1500 ppm. But by the time they're 8.5, 9, they should be able to spit out completely. So it is safe for them to use. And personally, I feel fluoridated pastes are better because of the amount of processed food that is regularly there in our diet. It is better to have a paste which is high on fluoride. Coming to the diet part, when I said the kids' diet has to be very healthy, so coming to the diet and dental caries part, this is something that I came across in AAPD, that is Academy of American Pediatric Dentistry. This guideline is amazing. I don't know, I mean, I myself don't know how I'm going to follow this, but it says fruits and vegetables should occupy at least half of what our children eat. Just the fruits and vegetables should occupy half of what our children eat. So yeah, this is something I'm going to try to, incorporate. Coming to the grains, whole grains are better. We also know that the oatmeals, the whole wheat grains, the brown breads, they are any day better than the processed one. Coming to dairy, it is better to use a low-fat dairy for children also. Green leafy vegetables, it's been told to us from generation, is very, very good in general for the digestion and even for the teeth point of view, because green leafy vegetables like broccoli and palak are very rich in calcium. And when we talk about calcium, I need to tell this: once the teeth have erupted into the mouth, how much of a calcium we take orally is not going to help. So if the milk teeth are weak or a little hypoplastic or less in calcium, that means the child had a calcium deficiency when the teeth were formed, that is in utero, that is inside the uterus. And if the permanent teeth are hypoplastic or less in calcium, that means the calcium deficiency was in the first few years of life. So teeth are never a good indicator of the present calcium status. For some reason, if you feel that the child is deficient in calcium or may not be getting enough calcium or vitamin D, it is always better to get it checked with the pediatrician. Proteins are again very good for the ameloblast cells, which help in the formation of the tooth. So egg, chicken, poultry, beans, peas, legumes, all of them should be of sufficient quality in the child's diet. Now, when we talk about diet, there are okay, when we talk about diet and dental caries, there are four things that are important. So there are the three most important part is there is the bacteria, there has to be the tooth, of course, and the sugar. So in the part where all of the three are together for a certain amount of time is when the caries can occur. So we as parents will always have to keep thinking which one can we monitor, which one can we help to make sure the caries does not occur. Bacteria, coming to the bacteria, Streptococcus mutans are known to cause the dental caries. So to keep the bacterial count down, of course, the brushing twice, the warm salt water rinses, and rinses after every meal, all this would significantly help us in reducing the bacterial count in the mouth. Coming to the teeth, now of course a tooth has to be there for dental caries to occur, right? Like in a baby without any teeth, the dental caries cannot occur, and that is the time there are no streptococcus in the mouth also. So only when the tooth starts erupting in the mouth, will the streptococcus count also increase in the mouth and slowly cause the cavities. So in the teeth segment, we need only thing that, of course, apart from brushing, that we can look into as parents is the shape of the teeth. So sometimes genetically, the shape of the teeth have deep grooves which tend to hold on to the food for longer. So if the food is going to be stuck in this grooves for a longer duration of time, it can cause cavities again. So if you feel the food is staying much longer in the mouth, then there's something called a sealants which will help in making these grooves a little shallow and maintaining the cleanliness in the tooth. Coming to the sugar, sugar itself is a different, sugar is something I would like to discuss a little bit in detail, because when we come to sugar, it is, of course, there is the quantity of the sugar, but more importantly, we have to look at the consistency of sugar. So anything that is going to stick in the mouth, like I said, tooth bacteria, sugar for a certain amount of time. So anything that is going to stick onto the tooth is the one that will cause cavities. So anything sticky, like sticky chocolates can cause more cavities. Seemingly harmless chapati jam rolls can cause cavities. Then even maybe ice cream, because ice cream would probably dissolve and get inside, but this chapati jam roll that we make will stay in the mouth for longer. So I don't know, I used to tell this, when you put in the snack box for kids, so I guess when the schools reopen and when we put in the snack box, so it is better to check, like, you know, we can eat and see how long is that sticking into our mouth and dependently decide on the snack for children. So that's what the duration that it is there is very important. Sticky carbohydrates tend to stay longer. Something like a lollipop, which the child is continuously licking for a long time, will stay longer in the mouth. So again, those are the things that we need to look into. And the third thing is the frequency. So basically what happens is when I take in sugar, the sugar sticks to the tooth and the bacteria metabolize it, produce acid. So the tooth and the surrounding area becomes acidic. That's how the calcium moves out of the tooth. So the saliva then comes in and tries to neutralize that acid and protects the tooth. Now by once the saliva will come to neutralize it, and again if I'm going to have some more sweets repeatedly in you know, increased frequency with shorter gaps, then repeatedly there will be an acid attack on the tooth, which my saliva will not be able to neutralize. That's how there is rampant caries or multiple caries seen in a child's mouth. So these few things, if we can, you know, look into, will surely help in preventing cavities. One is we have to look at keeping the bacterial count extremely low. That is the oral hygiene instructions that we need to follow. We have to make sure the anatomically the tooth is healthy. It's not weak, it's not hypocalcific, or, you know, the shape wise it is not holding on to carbohydrates for long. And thirdly, we have to look into the sugar part, the consistency of the sugar and the frequency and the duration that it is going to stay in the mouth. So I say, if you really have to give a chocolate, give something soft, give something small that dissolves in the mouth faster than something that is sticky, gooey, and is going to stay in the mouth for longer. And it's not only chocolates. Any sticky carbohydrate can cause cavities. It can be chapati jam, chocos, Oreo biscuits, any of them. If it's going to stick onto the child's tooth and if it has sugar in it, it will cause cavities. Coming to the dental emergencies, especially now that, you know, most of us are at home and we are not able to go out, I thought I will let you know what are the dental emergencies that we can come across and how we can manage that. Most of the dental emergencies are either related to pain in the tooth or a trauma, that is a fall or an injury that happens suddenly. Okay, now the causes of pain. What are the causes? What could be the common causes of pain? Of course, cavity. So if there is the child complains of pain, and when you look into the mouth you find a cavity, then you can relate that the pain is due to cavities. Secondly, a fractured tooth, trauma. So if the child has had a fall and the tooth is chipped or completely broken, it will be associated with pain. Third is an abscess tooth. Along with cavity, you can see a boil or a swelling in the gum, like a pimple, a large pimple that is called as an abscess. So even these can be quite painful, or there can be the whole swelling of the cheek and the lower jaw, which can be associated with pain. There's of course teething pain. This is more common when the permanent teeth start coming. So the first permanent molar, which comes behind all the milk teeth, this comes somewhere around 6 years of age, and that's the largest tooth even in our mouth compared to all the other teeth. So when that comes, yes, it can cause a lot of pain and discomfort. So check for that if the child is complaining of pain in the back tooth region. Sometimes that tooth is also covered by a gum tissue, which is called as operculitis, if it is troubling or if there's an inflammation in that area. So again, that is something that we really need to look into. There could be a tooth that is non-vital or a dead tooth. And for example, it happens especially with the front tooth milk teeth. The child could have fallen few days or few months or even year back, but suddenly the tooth would change color and start hurting now. So it is if the tooth has become dead inside and is got infected, it is when it can start hurting. Now the pain can be of different types. So there can be pain only while eating, which subsides on the own. That means the cavity is not very deep, but might require filling, but obviously needs to get a checkup done. The pain which is severe and doesn't subside on its own, you need to give the child some medication. Then there is pain which is at night. So daytime there is a little discomfort here and there, but night child gets up with severe pain. Then there is pain which is associated with swelling that usually is accompanied with fever. There's pain because of the bleeding gums. Then pain after a filling. Yeah, this is another thing that we as parents should be aware of. So when you see the mouth, you see the tooth, there is a filling. So it is nice and well covered, but still the child is complaining of pain. So this happens if the cavity has been deeper. Sometimes the cavity progresses much deeper to the nerves, but it does not touch the nerve. So we as dentists try to be less invasive and probably just fill the tooth up and see, you know, let's see how it is doing. So it may not hurt at that time or even for months after that, but suddenly the child may complain of pain. And if you see the filling is still looking good on top, it is still better to get the child checked, probably take an x-ray and see what's happening below it. Pain of a broken tooth, a fractured tooth, like I told you, sometimes the pain is not immediate. It can happen even months and years later. Now, what can we do for the pain? I mean, what would we dentists do? Like if you come to us or if you go to a dentist with a pain, then usually an x-ray is taken. Depending on the x-ray and depending on what it suggests, how deep is the cavity and where the new tooth is, we can decide on what needs to be done. More importantly, what can we do at home? Salt water gargles are the first thing that you need to start with. Don't use warm salt water gargle. Use a room temperature salt water gargle. If there is swelling, please use cold compression. Nothing warm, nothing hot. Whenever there is a dental infection, swelling, pain, discomfort, anything warm can aggravate it. So it is best to use cold compression. Wrap some ice in a t-shirt or cold packs. Just place remove. That will help in bringing down the swelling, and it will also give comfort. Clove oil and clove. I've heard many parents, moms tell me that, you know, they had used clove oil or clove in the area of pain, and that had helped the child. So clove does work, though I have not come across any studies, but yes, I think it does work for immediate relief. And now most of the dentists are available on for teleconsultation or a quick video consultation. And till you have seen a dentist or spoken to a dentist, it is always better to put the child on soft room temperature diet. Like I said, anything hot can aggravate the dental pain. I guess that is one thing why kids like us, because we always ask them to have an ice cream after the dental treatment. So yes, anything cold is good for the dental pain. Like I said, if there is pain and if it's not subsiding, a video consultation can be done. Now, when we speak about video consultation, why has it become very important now? Of course, because of the COVID situation. But even from the governing bodies, we've got the instructions to always do the video consultation. And usually the first visit involves understanding what is the type of pain, maybe some medications. And then when you visit next, we can directly do the treatment. So it would reduce your number of visit to the clinic. And how are video consultation done? There is a format, a form that you need to usually fill in. Attach the pictures of the relevant tooth, a clear picture of the relevant tooth and the symptoms when we discuss with you, discuss with child. When we see the child, we understand if there's something that we missed out. All this put together can help us reach to the diagnosis and understand why the child is having pain. Yeah, that is about video consultation and dental visits. Now, coming to the dental visits during COVID situation, I know most of us would be a bit apprehensive, but what can we as parents do? So, of course, like I said, there is video consultation. In that, it's better to discuss about your queries before you visit itself, and even the post-treatment concerns if you have, because it will reduce your time at the clinic. Secondly, the visit to a dentist or any physician should be an informed visit. That is, an appointment has to be taken. So it's not only about the time, but now even the dental work area needs to be allotted. So that would be very helpful. Try being on time. Always call the dentist or the dental staff from the car. Or, once you reach the dental office, please call us so that we can check whether the room is ready and then call you in. Keep the mask on. Please wear your mask when you go to a dentist. Once you reach the dental clinic, we might give you your own PPE, which may involve mask, head cap, gloves, shoe cover. This mask that is given at the dentist, please wear it only for the time that you are at the dentist. Like once you're leaving the dental clinic, remove the mask, dispose it off in the medical bin, and then wear the mask that you came with, and then you can leave. Digital currency is better. Preferably go home directly after your dental visit and wash your hand, mouth, hand, face, legs. I mean, anywhere you go and come back, it's better to either to take a quick bath or at least wash hand, face, and legs. I think that's what it is about dental caries in children and the emergency problems that we can come across during this time. Are there any questions that you would want to ask, or any pictures, any concerns that you have? We can discuss now. Actually, I like this type of conversation. I think I'm gonna have this live session with the rest of my family members also. This is cool. Only I get to speak and no questions, no doubts. Oh my God, there were so many. I didn't you sound. How to Reshma, moms and stories had asked me how to ensure smaller kids brush regularly, especially in the night time. So like how bathing is also an issue with kids initially, right? Even though it is not hurting, they are resistant to something new. So smaller the child, earlier we develop the habit, better it is. So for kids, we can make it playful by, you know, connecting it with all the brushing songs or, you know, their favorite cartoon characters brushing. So all this will help to develop the habit. Initial stages, I think why it's called Terrible Twos and Troublesome Three is because that is the age kids develop a lot of resistance. And if we keep, you know, we manage to incorporate this habit of brushing twice in that age, then moving forward, it would be very easy. And I think till at least the child is 7 years, it is better we brush the child's teeth at least once. Like I know somewhere around 5, 6, they are so rebellious, they want to do everything themselves. Let them do the morning brushing, especially the night brushing. It's better we as parents do, because that will help in making sure the permanent molars that come around this time and are most prone for cavities remain clean. Because kids cannot, you know, reach the back of the tooth and clean it well. Anisha asked me, while brushing at night, is tongue cleaning mandatory too? Tongue cleaning is mandatory, but it's better not to use those metal ones that we used to get earlier. Some of the brushes have a abrasive surface behind, like a irregular one, which can be used, or a brush itself can be used to gently clean the tongue. Fruit, Charmin asked me about the fruit sugars. Fruit sugars are better mostly because they are fibrous in consistency, most of the fruits when we are chewing and eating. So though banana, eating at night and sleeping is being associated with cavities, and there are studies that said that it does cause cavity if the banana is staying on the teeth for longer. But fruit sugars are of course much, much more safer than the processed sugar. Should we worry about taking the children to dentist now? Any precautions? I think there should be any worry or a concern for taking the children to dentist now, because of this whole lockdown stage, Reshma, we are seeing a lot of kids with more advanced cavities. So I would suggest it's better to talk to a dentist, understand what is the situation. Find out if it's an emergency, find out if it's a progressive one, if there's any risk of, you know, child having a cavity and which is going to progress, it is better to visit the dentist. And of course, we have to take the precautions, like I said, you know, schedule the appointment, check once you arrive, call the dental office and check if you can go, and wear your mask. And once you're back home, just, you know, clean yourself, and if possible, just take bath. Anisha said that the online consultation process is extremely convenient. Thank you, Anisha. I'm so glad it was helpful. Princy, thanks a lot. Anupa, Unni Krishnan, thanks a lot for that. Anupa asked me, what is the best toothpaste for a 5+ year old child? So I think 5 years and above, the child should be able to, you know, spit out most of the paste at least. So we can use a mildly fluoridated paste. That is, the fluoride content should be between 350 to 500. That will give us the benefit of the fluoride also, and will have less toxic effects. So yeah, any fluoride, any fluoridated paste with fluoride between 350 to 500 ppm should be good. To name a few, you have Pediflor, you have Cheerio, I think Colgate and Pepsodent kids also have fluoride in that range. So that should also be good for a child who's 5 year plus. Shall we end the session? I think. Hi to him also. Lots of love to all the three children, yeah. I have to check with you regarding his habit, Akhila. So I guess I'll end the session. Anyway, this would be on the page. So if there are any questions, you can you know, type it, and I will surely get back and answer them all. Thanks all of you for being here. Thank you.